to another Linux Gamecast Weekly, the show that covers the latest Linux gaming news, reviews, how-tos, and most importantly, whatever the hell else we come up with. This week, the Steam Machine launch sale is live, featuring great deals on games you already own, and Rocket League accidentally leaks Linux requirements, and they are fascinating.
Google's involved with a whole new type of glass. Lunar G's Vulcan team is shattered, and Unvanquished releases Alpha 45 and fixes their commit bot?
Show us what you got!
Sandy Man! Yes, Sandy tells us about how he got his hands on the P, and Intel's got a leak, and we go over their new Flagship CPUs. Flagship, not Flagship.
There's a show title
right there. I'm Vince Stone here in LGC Actual, switching the bits, doing all this nightmare fuel, joined every week. You know him. You love him. Our Canadian team podcaster, Master Huang. And all the way from Blaze Portugal.
Hello!
Blaze Morizzo himself, and together with Chatroom Dynamic joining us live, we all together form just a little bit of a cocaine Voltron. Before we get started, we'd like to see what's going on in each other's life organs. I'm going to start because it's kind of wintertime, Brad. It's kind of just a little bit. Unless you're in Space Australia, then it's kind of summertime coming in. But it's normally, you know, not getting too hot, much higher than about 10 lately, and I'm pretty good with that. So I was like, okay, time for the winter. I don't like reverse when it comes to that. I was like, hey, I'm going to shed a few pounds here. Easiest way for me to do that is, you know, you just like cut back on the booze, and by that, and he's like, don't drink every day, man. I was like, okay, I'm gonna give that bit of a try. The only thing is the main reason I drink is to shut down my brain organ. Nope, that's a tough fucking sell trying to go to bed. You're sitting there at 4:45 in the morning, and you're like, well, I need to be at the radio station in 3 hours. Okay, we're awake. Let's just say the house is very clean. J-Man, you got hold of some Gaben.
Oh, yeah. I picked up the Steam controller when it hit GA on Wednesday. Uh-huh. So I've been playing around with it, mostly Trine 3 and Trine 2, because those are the games that we're playing this week. I've tried a bit of Portal. Yeah, FPSs are super playable with this thing. Good job on that. Funny story about it, though. I set it up wirelessly on this computer, then I brought it all over to the den to set it up on the TV box, which actually just got a 750 Ti, so now it's all nice and gamer ready. YOLO swag, 30 FPS. Well, beyond 30 FPS, anyways. But, so, I plugged this into the TV, and it's not working. So, I go check my UDEV rule, that's in place, reboot Linux, restart Steam, all that good stuff. And about 10 minutes later, I realized this is actually not plugged into the computer. This is plugged into the PlayStation 4. So I can at least confirm that the Steam controller doesn't actually work on the PlayStation 4. But once you move that cable, it worked fine. That's my brain part of the week.
On my end, I was also futzing around with my Steam box. I decided to try all the games that claim they have full controller support. Just download them, try them, see if they actually have it. And that got me thinking. You may remember that Valve was apparently going around and removing the SteamOS bit from non-compliant games. They missed a few. The sheer number of games that actually claim full controller support and don't have it is staggering.
Well, you know what else is staggering? The, I guess you would call it a very soft release of the Steam box.
Of the horse?
Yeah.
The horse? Yeah, no, the horse was promising Big Bang, and we got a little bit of a whimper. It's our Steamworks!
Update!
Oh my god, here it is. Steam Machine launch sale. Play the games on your Steam machines. Alien Isolation. Not a bad deal. 50% off. Yeah,
good, yeah.
Pick it up. Yeah. We, Ark, do not buy that. That thing's a busted mess. Ezek, Rebirth, the Borderlands, we got the XCOMs, the Shadows of the Mordors, the Taloses.
Don't get the Biocock. Don't.
Yeah, that's an Eon port. Broforce, Bastion.
Yeah, there are a bunch of good games on here that we've thrown shares at that you should pick up because they're really, really cheap right now. Bastion, Transistor, if you haven't got that. There's quite a few. But no new releases. That was a wee disappointing. Very, very quiet. We were expecting some Rocket League, but I guess Ven will talk about that a little bit later.
I don't know. I mean, there's like a soft launch, and then there's like five floppy inches pressed against your forehead soft launch.
A little push.
I mean, P-Man, I mean, if I had spent all the money developing Steam boxes and getting that out, getting on the store and releasing them as a hardware manufacturer, I'd be kind of pissed off.
That's the thing. Valve hasn't even acknowledged the fact that they kind of screwed up with the Steam Machine release. So they might say, no. In a couple of days, they might say, oh, no, the Steam Machines haven't technically released yet. There were some issues, so we're delaying it. I don't know. If this was the actual release, it's pretty disappointing.
You had some SteamOS bug recently, didn't you, Pedro?
Yes, I did. The Steam Box is running SteamOS proper, and there was an update yesterday, and all of a sudden, it started crashing, like, for no reason whatsoever. I was playing a game, and all of a sudden, the screen went black, and I'm like, okay, that's not good. And not only does it crash the Steam Big Picture mode, as it also crashes the game. So it's pretty bad. But speaking of Steam boxes, Sandy,
oh my God,
he got his hands on the Cyber Steam Machine P. He says it's like a unicorn. A lovely, lovely unicorn. That's not the words he used,
it's
but
special,
whatever.
All right.
Special, yeah. Yeah, so he has the Core i5 at 3.4 gigahertz with the GTX 960. That's a full-size GTX 960, not the 960M, as some people in the comments have implied. Yeah, it's a pretty good deal.
Port on the back, DVI.
Yeah. It's a pretty good deal for the money. As far as Steam Machines go, it's when it comes to price per performance,
you either get
the Alienware one. It's
I don't know.
I think this one was closer to $1,000, wasn't it?
It was like 700 and something like that. Then you have Canadian tax and that and all that business.
Yeah.
One thing I want to point out that Sandy will be continuing a series on this for us, showing off the Steam controller, how it actually performs with several games and all that business. And I personally got to learned a completely new tool chain for editing 1080i.
Yeah.
Ooh, that was a thing.
The interlacing. Okay, so this is from Engadget.com. Links to all this crap in our show notes, as usual. And this is an article talking about the somewhat hostile reception towards the Steam controller. This one posits that people don't like it because it's different. And that is a very true statement. This is different. I didn't have so much of an issue getting used to mine, but I guess that's because I had heard other people's experience and was mentally prepared for what I needed to do to actually, you know, play games with the Steam controller and whatnot. I mean, it really takes about 5 minutes to hit the learning curve, and then you rock the damn thing. So if people are complaining that it's too difficult, they're morons, because I'm not that smart.
Jordan,
these guys can attest to that.
Jordan, what would you know about Steam controller?
I would know absolutely nothing about Steam controllers, having never seen or touched one in my entire life.
It
no,
seems
sir.
Legit. You know, granted, this thing is a bit of a moon device, but you got to think of it like this. I mean, if you could hack up a way to use this on the Xbox One or the PlayStation 4, you'd be banned for cheating.
We've already established
that's not. But you got to think about this, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls. This is not a replacement for your keyboard and gerbil. Nay. This allows you to play the games that would require such from the comfort of your own couch or NP, baby.
Yeah, the article goes on about saying, yeah, people don't like it because it's different, and the gamers say that the Steam Machines are pointless and that the controller is too alien to ever be mainstream. I'm waiting. I'm just waiting for the current console generation to quote-unquote end, just so I can see Sony and Microsoft try and sell not backwards compatible x86 30fps consoles. I want to see how that will fly in the face of quote-unquote pointless Steam Machines, because, you know, you buy a game now, chances are, thanks to the Steam runtime, static linking and all that, it's going to run a couple of years down the line. The same cannot be said about the Xbox 2 or the PS5. As for the controller, if it get rid of the mouse keyboard dependency for those games which developers couldn't be arsed to figure out proper controller input for, even though the game is very clearly designed for one in mind, I'm all for that too.
Yeah, the setup for this thing is fairly comprehensive. You can just straight up map keyboard and mouse buttons to any of the buttons here. So,
well, kind of one of the things I wanted to ask you about, J-Man, is, you know, it's wireless, correct?
It's wireless or wired. You can plug it in. Or...
you can just keep the little UBS controller plugged in.
So what I do is I have a 10-foot USB cable running to the couch from the other TV. I just pop that into this guy when I want to use it on this guy on the TV box, and I just use it wirelessly while I'm sitting here. So
super sway. Well, let's get disappointed,
so
fun.
You're the Rocket Man.
I'm the Rocket Man.
Burning. Shut up, Shatner.
And we all know about this. It's football, cars, and all this business. 1999, and guess what? It didn't launch, but it kind of did, baby. If you're looking at this on the video, but for you at home listening, they did have a SteamOS plus Linux requirement. So kind of weird, because they recommended Windows Vista.
listen. There was that XKCD comic from a couple years ago that basically came out and said Ubuntu is just Windows Vista with some custom themes. Confirmed! I knew it!
Yep.
I don't know. I mean, I was kind of disappointed about this because, you know, when you first see something, you're just like, oh, well, that's a cock up. Here it comes. And I was awake and I was like, oh, and it's even on sale now. It's got to be coming. It's happening. Hashtag Ron Paul JPEG.
I mean, it's not even
enough. And it's gone.
Yeah. I mean, that lasted for like 2 mothering hour organs and it just disappeared. What really, really grinds my gears is this came, you know, J-Man, you have a copy.
Yeah. Pre-order the Steam controller, get Rocket League. And yet when Steam controller and Steam machines come out for GA, no Rocket League. So what the hell was going on with that? Was there like some crippling game-breaking bug? How come we have not heard anything about this? Because I know a lot of people pre-ordered the Steam controller like, oh yeah, it's going to be awesome with Rocket League. And now they're fucking pissed off. I know I'd be.
Yeah.
Look at me, I'm Mr. Meeseeks.
Hey, Mr. Meeseeks, can you do a Garry's Mod version of yourself?
Ooh, yeah, I can! Yeah, I can! And there it is! Someone's actually gone out of their way to make a Mr. Meeseeks
available for
G5!
I swear to God, I will curb-check you if you
do that. Yeah, seriously, Pedro, you stop that right now, or we're just going to kill your call.
Okay, this is actually the first Rick and Morty-themed character model to come to Gmod. My guess, seeing as I am the great Plage Marizzo, is that it won't take long for at least either Rick or Morty to show up there as well. But in the meantime, you have Mr. Meeseeks.
Oh yeah, how about some of those threads there?
Well, let's talk about some modifications, because Alien successfully removed from the game, if you don't know what we're talking about, it's Alien Insulation from the fine folks at Feral Interactive. A strapping young lad has a Dropbox link. Show title that you can drop in there, and it's just a .bml file, and it basically nopes the alien, which, like, you know what? I might actually have a go with this, because you gotta face facts. Further in the game you get, the alien is more like, it just becomes a nuisance, especially when you're all powered up. You're like, ah, fuck off, flame it a little bit, throw a rocket, fetch bitch. But somebody compared it to another type of game.
Yeah, so if you scroll down to comment number 3 on that thread, you'll see that Peiko said, so you made quote-unquote Gone Home out of Alien Isolation?
Yeah, not 100% true, because the humans and the androids are still there. What I want to know is, can you replace the alien with Pedo Bear? That is our question for our age.
That's just a model swap.
Well, let's talk about some goals.
Sega.
It's your story, son.
Oh, it is, isn't it? Yeah. So, Football Manager 2016 came out recently. And it came out with a simultaneous release on Windows, Mac, and Linux. Not too bad. If you don't remember, $50. That's a bit rough, but that's par for the course while you're paying for Football Manager. For those of you who weren't aware because you've been living under a rock for the past 3 years, the last Football Manager came out And eventually for Linux, it wasn't simultaneously released with the Windows and Mac version. That's because this was still in proto Steam OS mode. What did you highlight there?
Earlier cards may require the DirectX 9 port. But that's also...
Well, yeah, because you need Mesa 9 for that, clearly.
Mac, yeah. It's a requirement for Mac as well. I guess at the end of the day, kind of what I was like, you know, Sega's getting kind of hella charming. You know, Alien is an installation. That was a Sega type, and we've got a couple other...
Zom Sonk the Hedgehog confirmed for Linux.
Yellow Swag.
It's called Action Hank.
Perfectly honest with you. You know, footballers, I can give, you know, two flying fucks about that, in all honesty. Infinitely more, it would break my give a shit a meter when it came to, like, managing that. But I know that some people really enjoy that, and I really think it's kind of an important thing because it was a same-day launch. So
And I mean, games released on Linux don't have to be stuff that we personally enjoy. I mean, the whole point is that there are more general appeal games out on Linux. And that's a good thing. That means that people will buy Steam machines and be able to play games and not spew crappy misinformation all over the internet. Gadget.
You know, speaking of crappiness, not misinformation per se, but devs just not giving a shit about their Linux version. This is War Game, European Escalation. This game has actually been out for Linux for... I don't know, 2 years,
two and
3 years.
Right. Full disclosure, it's they sent me an unsolicited key like 2.5 years ago. So
yeah, a long time ago, they sent Ben a key. And apparently there's a game-breaking bug with the Linux version. If you go to their Steam forums, you'll see there's a little post there of a guy running the NVIDIA GTX 970. The whole 3.5 gigs of it, and
check it
there's
out,
some
it's like
pretty
epilepsy simulator 9000.
Oh, yeah,
it's pretty bad. The aliens are attacking. It's like that episode of Enterprise.
There's some really bad texture tearing, like when the textures get stretched all over the screen. It's either the textures or the shaders. It's one of those. I had something similar happen with Euro Truck Simulator 2 back in the day. When I force enabled VSync, it kind of went away, but if I disabled VSync entirely, it was completely unplayable. Now, this one, people have gone all the way to the moon and back trying to figure this out.
You need to remember that this has been busted since November 23rd, 2014, but... Pedro,
yep.
You must understand the fix for this is completely... They would have to rewrite the entire engine.
No, they would not. As you pointed out in the show notes, Arthur Hewlett,
Rodney.
sorry for butchering your name, man. All they need to do is rebuild the game without a single flag in the OpenGL map buffer range function call. That's all they need to do, literally. Just take out that flag, rebuild the game.
And they haven't done anything about it either. It's so lazy. No. I mean, take it from someone whose job was literally compiling software 24/7. Compiling shit is hard. Running make requires a lot of effort to hit the M, the A, the K, and the E flag. And if you have more than one CPU, you gotta do a space dash J and then a number. It's so difficult, man. I'm exhausted just thinking about it. Really, I am.
I guess what we're saying is that these ass banjos are still selling this business, even if it's $9.99. But, I mean, if you go back and look at the complete pack, you know, $49.99. Now, granted, we do have the Steam refunds, but still, they should not be selling knowingly busted software on the store when there's no warnings or anything like that. So I think J-Man's right. They're definitely on our shite list, right?
On the shit list until you fix that, and even then you better fucking make up for that. But coming up next, we talk about cores coming out of every single
Jordan.
No, I'm gonna let you finish.
But we need to thank some people this week.
No, we got to thank them after the news, because we've been doing it after Steam for like the past 3 weeks.
No, it's in the notes, son. You just didn't read them.
It's in the notes, yeah.
Patreon!
Patreon.
All right.
Yes. Patreon.com/LinuxGamecast. It's awesome. It's amazing. We're at $140 an episode!
What does that mean?
$140.84.
That we have a brand new show for you, Left 4 Brad 2, where we take one of our lovely Super Squad members and we go kill some zombies with them on a weekly basis. It's going to be good stuff. We're playing Left 4 Dead 2. We're going to go through the entire Left 4 Dead 1 campaign, the entire Left 4 Dead 2 campaign, all the ancillary missions, and then maybe we'll do some DLC, some Steam Workshop stuff.
Jordan,
why the fuck not?
How can I get on this? Maybe I want to join you guys and play along.
It's really simple. All you really have to do is donate $1 a show or more to be eligible. The 5 cents show, guys, we love you, but you gotta be a Super Squad member. You gotta be on the Wolf Slayer in the forums to actually register for this. It's not that much money. It's about buying us a beer every month. You'd want to buy us a beer, wouldn't you? A single crappy American beer, even. It's not even a good one.
I'd be me, but my Truggles points out we're just a few quid away from the Linux Gamecast Weekly Daily Wednesday, maybe.
Yeah.
$9.16.
Yes, we are. It'll be our midweek show for all things Linuxy, all up in your face. But to actually thank the proper people of this week who upped their Patreon donations, Mr. Kim O and Michael P. Thank you very much, Michael. You're completely insane, and I love you for that.
Yeah,
and Kim, you just need to quit being so damn awesome. And we know the whole thing is. I mean, it's not about like 5 cents. It's like 5 cents, 20 cents a month. Yeah, I'll do that. It's you got to feel like I felt it originally because there's a bunch of shows on Patreon. And I was like, oh shit, this is what I watch for entertainment now because I don't watch the TVs. And I don't even have like a beard, a plaid shirt, or a fixie, but I still.
You totally have a plaid shirt. I've seen it. Don't lie.
Yeah, screw you. but it was always the thought of like, I gotta go log in. Pretty fucking painless, man. You log in. You can use your face butts if you have one of those regular login. You can even use your PayPal. You don't even have to do the credit card number and all that business. So we just want to thank you for that. And we're just trying to give you 110%. Of whatever you can give us. I mean, we want to dance for our money, basically.
Yes, basically, much like we got to turn that organ and grinder so Pedro can do his little monkey dance. But up next, as I was saying, Core's out the wazoo, and Google gets a bit grabby with some external companies.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, Van and Jordan just made me concede in the middle of a Hearthstone match, but it's the news! And first up, to break a little bit of LGC tradition, we're not talking about drivers, we're talking about Intel and their new processors, not performers.
i7-6950X rocks 10 cores and 20 thread organs.
Yeah, that's a lot of threads.
Is it going to be a MOBO melter, though?
Well,
this was supposedly a leak, but I've grown far too jaded to believe that these kinds of leaks are never actually leaks. They're on purpose. So, yeah, you got the whole new lineup of flagship systems when it comes from Intel. It's the i7-60, or like the previous generation had the i7-5960X, which was an 8-core, 16-thread processor. And now you have the 6950X and the 6850K, which is the not-so-expensive but still pretty expensive because it's an Intel processor we're talking about. And the 6800K, which is supposed to be the flagship consumer-grade processor. Not exactly enthusiast level, but close enough.
Well, I mean, this is not the first time. The Xeon series from Intel, Team Blue, like Filthy Jordan is now, the traitor.
more like Team Jew, am I right?
Okay, whatever. However you want to do that, shalom. They did 10 cores on the Xeons. Those things still retail for like $1,200 to $1,300 a pop. Yeah. But the estimates, I'm guessing this is going to be the new 999 Evil When I Do Handstands part of business. But J-Baby, you kind of had some like, buyer's remorse.
Yeah, I saw that. And for about a quarter of a second, I was like, shit, motherfucker, bitch ass. But then I realized there is no way in hell that I'm ever going to justify to myself paying like $1,000 for a CPU. It was hard enough paying $500 for a CPU. There's that. I mean, they're going to run great, but you're not really going to get much in the way of gains, especially because, like we've said a lot of times, most of the time games are single or dual threaded. You're going to get all these wonderful CPUs that are going to sit there and idle doing nothing.
Yeah, the new i7 6950X is a 10 core 20 thread CPU, which is probably going to run you for around $1,200 ish, according to WCCF Tech. Links for all of that in the show notes as usual. But yeah, it's starting at the low price of one arm and a leg.
No, Pedro. The price is baby hands and Whitey's got to pay.
Why are all the baby hands white?
Well, you know, Whitey's got to pay, son. I mean, that's just kind of the whole issue. But here's what I'm thinking.
Carl!
By the time this comes out, hopefully, hope beyond hope, because now that we know that GoFlow, GlobalFoundries, have their 14 nanometer processes down, that we will see the 16-core AMD server and hopefully consumer variants for the low price of $998.99. But wait,
I'm sorry, Ben. We're not competing on price.
Well, you know, that's what I'm saying. I mean, there's going to be a little bit cheaper, you know, like a few pennies. Ultimately, what I'm hoping is that does take effect, and that 500 quid Intel Skylake processor that J-Man bought last month, I'll be able to pick up like 250, 350. Somewhere in there. So, win, and it's all speculation, but let's Vulcan this business up.
Yeah, this is from LunarG.com. You might remember these folks. They're the guys who Valve contracted to make some Mesa driver improvements. Though I actually did a bit more research. Glassy Mesa is actually a bit of middleware that converts their GLSL to a standard GLSL. But anyways, they are doing a little split. Google has decided that they really, really, really want a piece of the Vulcan on the mobile. And so their mobile group is now under the thumb of Google. Of course, the desktop group is still working very closely with Valve to ensure that Vulcan has a smooth desktop release. But I mean, it makes sense. Google is like, Android gaming is very much a thing. Pedro is freaking addicted to it. There are lots of people who play games on their tablets now. They don't even bother getting a console or a PC. So you want to have that good performance, and Vulcan is the way to do it. It makes perfect sense. Well, guys, do you got any thoughts?
I like the way you're thinking about this. You're just thinking about tablets. Imagine when we get Vulcan on things like the NVIDIA Shield. Not the NVIDIA Shield or the NVIDIA Shield,
The set-top box.
Yeah, yeah. The third shield that is not Shield. And
you mean Marvel's Agents of?
Shut up, Coulson. That's kind of where I'm thinking about.
Gotta give
this.
You a hand for that one.
No more puns. You're dead to me. What we really got to think about, though, what we generally got to think about is that actually could make viable, you know, with your SoCs.
ARM-based consoles. Yeah,
system
chips. That would actually be kind of neat, especially if you have, like, I don't know, like a Schmach type deal that has like a 64-bit ARM CPU running Vulcan. That would be a pretty good handheld.
Not just ARM SoCs, but even x86 SoCs like APUs and good old regular Intel processors. It's a pretty good deal for everyone to get Vulcan and get it at a performance level where it's actually viable, especially for gaming, because this is Linux Gamecast, after all.
And again, develop your code path once, never have to touch it again.
Unless you're on the Xbox, but I'm not.
Or the Mac. But, you know, speaking of Xboxes, Macs, and the like, Unreal Engine 4.10 is out. Ben was very, very quick to note that right at the beginning, 53 improvements submitted by the community. And, you know, it's great because who better to debug your software than the people who are actually using it? And now that they have access to the source code and whatnot, they can do your work for you. It's brilliant. What this actually comes with is a bunch of bug fixes. If you're developing your UE4 game for Android, the NVIDIA Shield tablet the NVIDIA Shield controller now has support. A couple other third-party controllers for mobile have support as well. Linux, there's not really much, just some bug fixes. One interesting note, if you launch your Unreal game with the dash hyperthreading flag, it'll actually respect it and start using the hyperthreading features to increase your performance, which is some good sauce. But Pedro, you had some blurbs about repeating what I was saying.
Mostly. But yeah, making UE4 open source was possibly the best move that the guys at Epic could have made. Guys and gals, obviously. The community, test it, debug it, fix it, improve it, whatever. The only thing that Epic needs to worry about is like legal BS and proprietary integrations with drivers and other stuff. That's all they have to do. So this is going to be an engine that's completely developed by the community, and I want to see more games with it on Linux, because at this point we got like two.
Well, Pete, I don't think you're going to be sorely disappointed, because what I was writing in there, what I was trying to communicate is, I mean, this is why Unreal Engine 4 will be the dominant engine, not for Linux, but for Windows, Mac, mobile, and for the foreseeable future, because you don't have to pay a hefty licensing fee to get the source code for the engine. You get the source code for the engine. You find a bug in it. You might just be able to work around it. B, you can also send that shit upstream.
Or you can just fix it locally. And
exactly.
You know, go on with it.
Multiple ways around it. I mean, it's just brilliant. Epic is just firing in all cylinder organs. Quit being so awesome.
But you know who's not firing in all cylinders?
I don't know. Tell me about him. Duke Nukem These clowns. Also known as Overgrowth.
Yeah.
Alpha 210 changes.
Not Overwatch, that's the other one.
Yeah, from a good guy at Wolffire. You look at these amazeballs graphics for this game that's been in development for
over seven years.
They've decided not to use the Unreal Engine because it, quote, unquote, primarily supports Windows. These are the type of, these are the mental juggernauts we're dealing with. They have 5+ people working on the project, and the latest beta has an arena mode that we're seeing here that you can set up, and they promise, and they are absolutely super serial about this, that they'll release more than one update per year.
Okay. No, I don't believe that for a single second. And in the plagiarized words of Adam Gontier, whether this game is dead or still alive, I don't care. I honestly don't care about it anymore. By the time it comes out, if it ever comes out, which I highly doubt, by the
way. It's totally in early access for 30 fucking wood stinky cash.
Yeah, no. It will be a dated ass game in every single respect when it comes to everything. This, ladies and gentlemen, is what happens when you give a developer money without them having to do thing to earn
money. He's running in air.
Hold on. People are still giving these clods money for this crap?
I honestly hope not, but I'm far too jaded to have that much faith in stupid people.
No, this is from Wolffire Games, and we don't know that they were the originators of the Humble Bundle, but they've since parted ways. But you gotta expect that there's some financial ties. No. You just don't quit something like that. Now, riddle me this. We're in speculationsville here. I think 2 weeks ago, reported that Humble had to lay off, 12%? 20% of their workforce. And I think this might maybe have some correlation?
Possibly, sort of, kind of. I mean, it's the guy in charge of Wolffire was the guy who spun off Humble from that. But I don't know. There's not enough information out there regarding Overgrowth, though. I doubt this game has any appeal beyond its original core fan base, which wasn't really that much. I mean, Luguru was all right.
It was a decent enough game, but it didn't really pull anyone in. How often do you hear the
If you go to your average PC gamer on the street and you say, "What are you doing outside? Go back in your little crap shack," but and ask them, like, "Have you heard of Overgrowth? Are you interested in this game?" They're gonna go, "What? The hell's Overgrowth?" And that's that.
Yeah, I played Overwatch, but let's talk about what could have been.
What could have been was Borderlands Online, which is no more, and neither is 2K's China Studio, because it's shut down completely. And this comes from Rock Paper Shotgun, and the fine folks at 2K are apparently shutting down studios left and right, starting with the China one that was developing Borderlands Online, which most people never heard about because it was actually targeted at the Chinese market. There's a pretty big market for MMOs in China, so yeah.
Yep.
I kind of would have played it because...
I don't know. Yeah, I mean, I'm looking at this, and I've been around a long, long year. You know, pleased to meet you.
Many, many days.
Yes, rode the reins, general tanks, and all that business. But if you can remember back to the late 99s, early 2000s, mm-hmm. we saw this type of bubble going on. I mean, we had studios, game studios, and companies with these incredibly high burn rates that they didn't address, and that's why they went under. 2K is going to survive this because they're ahead of the game here, and they're like, we need to shut down things that are not making us money. We need to consolidate. Hey, we're going to put a studio in Vegas. We're not going to put a studio in San Francisco, the most expensive city in North America, to run out of.
So, hashtag Strider.
I'm just saying. They are thinking about this, and I got faith that we will continue to see a Borderlands series and more things from 2K, unlike other studios, who are more than happy to say, we need all this money for this because our burn rate's so high. And it's like, that's not sustainable, Brad. It's just not.
But then again, it's if they're not doing well, the studio they're opening in Vegas is not exactly a development studio. It's a QA office. It's...
They're going to multitask that shit, man. I mean,
why would you open a QA office in Vegas?
As opposed
open
to where? Why?
In the middle of...
Because you need to have your QA monkeys supplied with a steady stream of alcohol, gambling, and booze
and
keep them financially disparate or financially destitute enough to have to work QA in Vegas. Clearly, it's the perfect system.
Apparently, yeah.
But I mean, like, Borderlands Online, as a free-to-play MMO, Tabula Rasa has taught us anything. It's going to have a very loyal, very small, devoted core fan base that'd be really, really, really upset when they shut down those servers after 12 months.
I don't know. I just put a bow on this. It's kind of weird because I think that game would have garnered a lot more support if, I don't know, people knew about it.
Yeah, but then again, it was being developed for the Chinese market.
Dum 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 dum. Okay. Indeed. Color time.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah. Twister. Sun Vanquish. These guys have a new update. Alpha 45? Yeah. So they're getting colorful. What they mean by this, and this has nothing to do with half the stuff that goes on in that little article, is they added texty color bits. So if you type your messages in the chat windows, or if you have your little messages pop up, you can have 24-bit color now. It's insane. It's amazing.
I honestly think they have a bet at their office of who could put the most instances of color into it.
I'm also a bit disappointed about their commit bot, because there's no funny out of context commit messages here. Makes me a little bit sad.
Well, we do have the classic version pumped alpha 45.
It's classic. But the other thing that this release brings is a lot of code cleanup. Apparently they removed something like 2,000 lines of unused code or something. No, sorry, it was 7,752 deletions. So it's good that they're pruning their code base. Good on you for having, you know, good development practices, unlike some companies. Wolfire!
I remember the first time since, you know, I was on the show that we tried and vanquished, because that motherfucker would not run.
No, I had to make a how-to on how to get it to run back in the day, because, I mean, it took moon technology. But if you're wondering what is it, I mean, it is humans versus aliens. It's kind of like, what's the game?
Natural selection.
Natural selection 2, except this runs.
Another community-supported team shooter strategy.
Except that, you know, this one's completely open source and it has an active community. So take of that what you will, J-Baby.
Right. Up next, we get power! Throw some chairs at it and maybe break some magical artifacts. It's going to be fun. You know, it's really, really appropriate that we're wearing these wizardy robes with the hoods, because we're reviewing Trine 3 Artifacts of Unlimited Power! It's developed by Frozen Byte on the Frozen Byte Engine V3.0. You can pick it up for around $22 of your particular currency. You might have grabbed it on sale when it came out earlier this week with the Steam Machine launch. But what is it? Trine 3, The Artifacts of Power, is a platforming game of action, puzzles, and depth perception, and the sequel to the award-winning Trine and Trine 2. Reunite with three heroes in an all-new adventure, now for the first time in depth perception. And, of course, with all these chairquisitions, we have the chairquisition. Right. Next, one chair means that it's garbage, two chairs means that's crap, it's meh, three chairs means that's pretty good, four chairs means that's amazing. And I've been doing this for 3 years now, you think I get it right for once. We also have our categories of doom, mixed with the working shiny sounds, controls, and fun. So let's kick this off. Ven, was it powerful on your system?
With much powerful, over here in Vinland, with the 1404 Kumbuntu LTS. 980 powered 4K displayed Octo-ish Core 8150 AMD GPU of the business system. I'm going to say, where 4K support, Bren? Where? It's not there. It's just not a thing, man. J-Man isn't like some moon, like 2100.
No, it's just four times 1080p. That's...
No, I mean, like, resolution options, like, maxes out, like, not even
1440. It maxes out at 1900 by 1200.
Okay, I mean, but then again, ladies and gentlemen, boys and goyles, don't worry about that, because it doesn't matter, since at 1080p, with a 980, it can go anywhere from 24 to 113 FERPs, right in your face organ, for fuck and all reasons. It genuinely can. Doesn't matter. I mean, there's no logical explanation for it. It just happens. However, it does launch in less than a minute from two SSDs in YOLO RAID. Now, I know what you're thinking. Then it's kind of ridiculous. And I'm like, hello, person who just called me ridiculous. Have you played Trine 1 and Trine 2? That's called progress, son. Because those can take infinitely longer. Nothing is genuinely broken. I can't hit it at you. I kind of want to because there's a very laughable experience I had with it. Got in the game, you know, we picked up the game for the crew. First time I played it, and I was playing as the knight, Captain Beerbelly.
Pontius.
And my first genuine experience with that was I hit W, and it froze. So he just... ran off into the 3D and fell off the edge of the map and died to death. And that was a true story. Not reproducible. So I'm going to give it four chairs.
Yeah, I mean, the try and scream at screen of nope, like the configuration dialogue has always been a pain point for me just because it's so dumb. Why can't you just put that in the game? Everything else is configurable through the in-game menus. It just seems a bit excessive, but if you launch Trine 2 at full screen while your desktop is in 4K, the game will scale up to 4K, and it'll still be 1080p, but it will consume the entire monitor. Trine 3 will just completely nope three-quarters of my monitor and take up one 1080p fourth at the fucking bottom left, which is completely asinine. And better yet, it fucks up big picture mode so that big picture mode will be stuck in that little corner as well. So that's dung a chair. Everything else works fine, but come on, Frozen Byte. That's you had it working in the previous games. Why isn't it working now?
Three Did chairs. You play it on?
Oh, yes. I played it on the in the NVIDIA GTX 980 i7 6700K running Fedora 264 bit. Skylake, yeah, with the Steam controller.
Oh, super sweet. So that's three chairs.
All right, so over here on, I tried to play it on my Steam box, and the first thing I saw was the launcher, and I was like, yeah, we're having none of that. Press the home key on the Logitech F310, close that game, installed it on the Amiga, and yeah, it was all right. The launcher, like Jordan already mentioned, is Well, it's kind of lazy at this point. Everything else works just fine if you configure it through the in-game options. So why can you not have resolution and anti-aliasing and everything else? Well, I guess,
Pete, what you're trying to say is, I mean, it's useless with a Steam controller on a Steam box.
Yeah,
no, well, a Steam controller, I mean, like, the menus do work with a controller. They've been doing that since Trent 2.
It's useless. Yeah. But yeah, on my end, when I installed it on the Amiga with the FX8370E and the GTX 970 Strix with 16 gigs of RAM loading off of the YOLO RAID, just like Ven, it ran out of the box. It took around 20 seconds to load, which, coming off of the YOLO RAID, that's pretty bad. But again, I can't really ding in a chair for that, so 4 chairs.
All right, so that's 3 chairs to mix with working. I'm next as the shiny and the sounds, Ven! Did it shine? Did it sound?
It's the trining again. No, man. Carl, you don't sit. It's Trine, even with a 3D sauce. I mean, normally, it costs them, if you play Trine 1 or Trine 2, I mean, I'm surprised some people don't know that the levels, I mean, that's why I always had that, like, funky aesthetic style to it, because it was all rendered in 3D. You just had a locked 2D camera for it, and it kind of gave it that brilliance. Maybe they didn't render the other side of the characters or some shit like that, but in full 3D sauce, it will still crush your eye pussies right into the back of your eye socket organs. The same colorful world with the same fantastic amazeball soundtrack. I mean, it is absolutely brilliant, and I'm want to give it an extra chair for the Daleks. If you play the
exterminating
game, if you play the game, you know what I'm talking about. If you haven't played the game, just wait till we get to Trine 3, and you'll definitely find that out. I have very audio, video, it's just very satisfying. Very much Trine. I mean, it's pastel all the fucking things. So, yeah, 4 chairs. I don't normally throw that business down for shinies and sounds, but it's a Trine game. Even in 3D, they managed to pull that off. I'll give them that.
Well, I mean, it does look good, and the pre-rendered cutscenes are a nice touch, and the soundscape, voice acting, and whatnot is all consistent with what we've seen in previous Trine games, which is all well and good. The thing is, with this new engine sauce, it doesn't really look all that different from Trine 1 or Trine 1 Enchanted Edition or Trine 2. I mean, they updated the costumes for people and everyone looks a little different to better reflect what they show in the pre-rendered cutscenes. But, like, in terms of backgrounds and enemies and whatnot, it looks pretty much the same as Trine 2. I didn't see too much of a difference. So, it gets 3 chairs, doesn't get 4 because it's not really pushing anything, but it still makes it the pretty, so good on it for that.
And, well, around here, I have to say that the voice acting and the background music was still on par with Trine 2 and Trine Enchanted Edition.
Same composers, which is, same voice actors.
Huh? Yeah. So it's definitely on par. Very good job on them for that one. No complaints. The one complaint that I have, and I would actually give this game 4 chairs, weren't it for the fact that when the physics start fucking up, the jittering and general nonsense that come with it break whatever immersion I had at that point. It's completely nonsensical. I'll get to it further in the fun section, but for now, I'll have to give it 3 chairs.
All right, that's 3 very jazzy chairs. For Shining Sounds, up next is Control, and this is where it starts to fall apart. tell us about it.
Let's give it the beans! What can only be described as morbid curiosity, because this is like my unicorn platformer game. All other platforms, I insist to be able to play it with a controller. I don't know, maybe because, Trine 1 came out so early, with SDL 1.2, we didn't expect controllers. I just learned how to play this game, kind of like P-Man. We just play it with a keyboard and gerbil. But,
yep.
Out of said morbid curiosity, I tried to play it with the X-Clone controller, And one thing I noticed when I set that option, it was like reduce input lag. And I was like, why would that ever be needed? Then I go to the map and I was like hitting, it was like barely moving. I was like, nope, we're done with that. Out, not going to happen anymore. I gave up on that business. But the only thing, you know, I immediately switched back to keyboard and gerbil. But the only thing that allows for is better precision when you're getting yourself killed to death. That's about it. Yes. This is a 3D game with a lock 2D camera that moves around when it fucking wants. Yep. But you know what, Brad? I'm going to tell you. I'm going to drop some knowledge into your face organ. What would this simple little thing would have unfucked this game? We don't need full camera control for this game. This should not be difficult to unfuck in this particular game. We need just 20 degrees of camera control for left, right, up, and down. Just so we can kind of like, am I going to jump to my death? Maybe, maybe not. You can't really tell when playing it, but trust me, I mean, if you're watching the produced review version of this, you're seeing us doing exactly.
Running around like crazy. Running around like idiots, I think, is the proper term.
Control's not completely busted. Unfortunately, I'm going to have to give it two chairs, simply because there is no way outside of experimentation, not that there's anything wrong with that, to determine whether or not where you're going to land and get killed to death.
Yeah. So, I mean, like Vince, 3D platforming with no camera control is equal to rubbish. I tried futzing around the PlayStation 4 controller because I had a workable config in Trine 2 and Trine 1. Still rubbish. Keyboard and mouse is a little bit better, but my brain can't platform. But lo and behold, on Wednesday, I was able to pick up this guy, the Steam controller, the Steam Sauce, the Areola controller, and it kind of works for most characters except for Amadeus, the wizard. Because, god damn it, trying to maneuver boxes using twin sticks is
hilarious.
It's hilarious nightmare fuel. My god, it's just pretty fucking bad. Yeah, no, just a little bit of camera control would be nice, because then you can actually tell where the hell you're jumping! Hashtag falling tear death waiting for Pedro to resurrect me, and they're all like, no, we're just gonna have Pedro and watch this.
True story.
So... True story, yeah. There is no audio for the recording. I really regret that.
I'm not saying that we were actively trying to jump over Jordan's body, not to resurrect him.
Yeah, but yeah, I'll give this two chairs. This thing lives or dies on camera control, and it's pretty fucking bad.
Yeah, the death procession. You may remember that from last week. I genuinely can't process how many times I've died because I thought a given platform was at a certain depth when it was actually like 3 feet the other way. Keyboard and gerbil controls are fine.
They're especially hard for you because your eyes are all fucked up on top of everything else.
Yeah, I mean, I usually use the glasses. Uh-huh. So
you should really just poke your eyes out. Be done with it.
Keyboard and gerbil controls are about as tight as they were in Trine 2, so that's fine. Unfortunately, while the past games were 2.5D, like fully 3D rendered and 2D playing field, this one is fully 3D with zero when it comes to camera control. You want to pan that camera around to see if that jump you're thinking of making is actually going to land properly? Yeah, sorry, that's not going to happen. So for me, it gets two chairs.
All right, so that's two chairs for controls. It really should be one, but the controls actually do somewhat work. And finally, our subjective category, fun. Ben, you beat this thing, so would you say it's enjoyable from start to finish?
I beat this thing like a redheaded step organ. Unfortunately, it quickly becomes go back and hunt down all the trine angles. You missed the game. Seriously, the only thing keeping this critter from being 2 arms long. That's it. Trine is about puzzle solving, not collecting equilateral trine angles, hashtag puns. 8 achievements are even based on collecting said trine angles. Trust me. And The puzzles. We always like the puzzles. I mean, if you've watched our Trying Again series, I mean, we've been like, damn it. We'll get squad wiped before we even figured out a puzzle. But Trine 3, they're so simple, even an arch user can do them. It's that. Then we also have to address the fact that there are no power-ups in this. You know, not like in Trine 1 and Trine 2, especially where you can gain power-up points. You can get the flaming sword, the throwy hammer,
the planks.
Yes. Exactly, and all that. But that's just the tip of the Heisenberg, ladies and gentlemen. Because the unlimited lives, this is it. I mean, it's, okay, well, I die. Oh, just pick another character, run over here, and then everything's all resurrected. That caused me to take a lemmings approach to collecting the trine angles. It wasn't like, oh, well, how do I get up there and be safe? I was like, YOLO, yoink, die, run over, recollect character, as dumb as balls. Now, I beat this in 8-on, so we picked this up on sale, but it's normally, what is it, $19.99?
Mm-hmm. It was on sale for $10.
Right, and we bought a 3-pack. But at $19.99, that breaks down to 2.49 wet stinkies per enjoyment unit. And in all fairness, we curb checked Trine, the original Trine Enchanted Edition, in 10-ish?
Yeah, around 10-ish hours.
Somewhere. And everyone was like, well, you know, cut him slack then. I was like, this is, you know, it's a finished game. I remember when this came out of Early Access, reading the forums, because it wasn't in Linux Beta. Now it's finally in, you know, its full form. But even before it was in Linux Beta, immediately after it came out of Early Access, everyone on the forums was like, what? This game's not done. What the hell are you talking about? There should be, like, we've all beat it, and here's an example of how I would finish it. There is a crouching stealth mechanic built into Trine 3 that is never fucking used. It's in the game. You can do it. You will never.
I think it was once, and you had to crouch under a door.
You could probably have swung over it, son, with a different character. I'm just saying, that whole thing is built in there. Then we get to how it fucking ends. Because I beat it. You get to this and you're like, oh, you know, this last spinny circly thing of like, okay, YOLO. You jump in there, you run, and like, oh, plant monster. And it's like, oh, look, mini boss type thing. And I sorted that and it's like, out, peace. You've collected the first piece of the trine. All right, so the other people bitching about it apparently weren't lying. However, I'm going to have to give it a bit more fun organs than the rest of our motley crew, because if you can get it on sale, it's not too bad. But I think I'm thinking of it a bit sideways, because we do a Trine Again series for our Patreons, patreon.com/LinuxGamecast. We are going to be able to provide so much fuck-mothering entertainment from this busted-ass game. That's what I'm thinking. So,
it will be trined.
Yeah, I got to give it 3 just for that, because I'm just making some popcorn in preparation.
So. Oh, man. So before Pedro, Ben, and I all tried trined together to make the footage for this review, Ben and I fucked around with it for a little bit, and it completely fucked up my single-player game, because it dropped me, like, midway, or about a third of the way through the game. And then, I can't progress any further because I have to go back and play through all the tutorials in single-player mode and collect all the triangles. And, oh my god, that's all this game is about, collecting triangles. You have to, I'm fine with fetch quests. They're a staple in video games. Go out, do the thing, bring this back to me. It's all good. It's great. But they actually have to advance the plot. It is, you're actually trying to accomplish something in the context of the story. This is just collecting fucking fun bucks to buy levels in this game that I already purchased. Well, Ben already purchased, but whatever. This is the definition of one of these games that I have to choke down. I did not enjoy my time playing it. I mean, there are bits that are competently done. The 2D platforming bits are great until you realize that not everything is on the level with each other.
It was hilarious watching you fail. P-Man.
Oh, yeah.
There was a point where we were literally just collectively on a ledge. I was like, what's he going to do next?
Yeah.
No, we're just waiting.
Honestly, yeah, trying to play this with the Steam controller is not fun. Trying to play this with the Steam controller while on a lot of drugs is not fun at all. Let me tell you, that was part of why I was sucking so bad. Then you go back and you're sober and you're like, "Oh, that's not too bad. I'm just an idiot." This game just isn't fun. Trying to was like a really, really fun game. I really enjoy playing it. This, not so much. I'm going to give it one share. It's garbage. Don't buy it.
Yeah, I'm kind of with Jordan on that one. Some games shine in multiplayer. The only thing that shines in Trine 3's multiplayer are the bugs. At one point on Thursday, when all three of us were playing together, I had three reticles on screen. That's usually the cursor you see floating around, and if you're playing as a thief, Zoya, like I was, you kind of need that to aim at shit, to like hook things with a little grappling hook and tie stuff together. You need that. But for me, there were three fucking reticles on screen, and now figure out which one. Okay, that one's moving. That's probably the one. Alright, okay. The physics are constantly fucking up, be it in single player or multiplayer. At one point, again, during that Thursday thing, me and Ven were waiting on Jordan to make a jump. It was one of those trampoline jumps when you have to time the jumps properly, and with the physics fucking up, it's hell. But we were waiting on Jordan to do that, and the physics glitched out so bad that one of the platforms that are there to help you, supposedly, shot up and nailed itself onto the physics ceiling and just stayed there.
Show title.
Physics ceiling.
The physics ceiling, yeah. Honestly, I don't want to play any more of this game until we actually need to, which is when we finish trying to
Many years in the future. Oh my god.
Yeah, not. It won't be long now. But yeah, it's not horrible, but I don't really want to play it. So two chairs.
And that gets inexplicably two chairs for fun, and even more inexplicably two chairs for the final score. But that's the
Jordan,
low end.
You're just
two
being
chairs.
Negative.
What?
You're just being negative.
Okay,
I'm being such a negative Nancy.
Final thoughts on this business. Frozen Byte, they've always been good. I mean, they finally got around. We have no relation with Frozen Byte whatsoever.
None.
So, get that out of the way. I mean, we're not angry or happy or anything like that. Very neutral. When they did this, it was reported that this game, what you would call the first part of a game, cost over $5 million. I mean, kudos on them for trying something a bit different, Sauce. They didn't quite pull it off, and they even released an apology video, which was like a very underhanded apology shit, and I'm still not forgiving girlfriend for wearing those yellow pants. That's a long-standing issue.
It's a fashion crime.
And they just came out. I mean, like, it was like, we'll never release DLC for this. And I was like, man, that's a good way to shoot yourself in your fucking foot when it's next to your chest.
Chest foot.
Chest foot, baby. And on top of that, I mean, they even released a new level. I don't know what the new level was. I guess it was a challenge area. I mean, you can skip you can skip everything but the most two bullshit challenge areas and get all your trine angles, hashtag Jesus Christ, Hail Santa, and get all that business and finish the game. And when you finish the game, the game ends on cliffhanger, and Frozen Byte came back and were like, oh, we always intended from Genesis that this was going to be part one, but we never communicated that to anyone. Give us money? Question mark.
That sounds like bullshit.
Yeah,
I mean, at this point. No, go ahead, Jordan.
I was gonna say, like Ben said. I mean, you can't fault them for trying something different. If trining something different. If you stick to your formula for too long, you begin to stagnate. And your games just start being uninspired. Drivel, hashtag Call of Duty, hashtag Madden, NFL, whatever.
Too spooky for you, but,
yeah, too spooky 360 no scope. But I mean, you certainly tried something that good on you, but you failed. You failed pretty hard. Honestly, like the removal of the advancement system, the really and then 3D aspect, what seems very, very much tacked on. And just the fact that the game amounts to one giant fetch quest doesn't really do you any favors when it comes to making a playable game that has the legacy of trying one and trying two.
8 hours of gameplay with 4 hours of going back and collecting triangles.
Yeah, I know. It's brilliant. It makes you really feel like you spent your time in a productive way, doesn't it?
No, it doesn't. It's artificially inflating playtime, and that doesn't sit well with anyone that's actually employed and looking to make the most out of their time, and they bought a game and they just want to finish it, and they don't want to deal with that kind of bullshit. Not to reiterate anything that Ben or Jordan already said, the only thing that I can say in favor of this game is, like, if you like Trine 1 and Trine 2 and you play through all of that and you want to see how the story progresses, I won't say that's how it ends, because it clearly isn't.
Isn't there a good place people can watch that progression?
Well, yes. You could donate to our Patreons and get
just go to YouTube
earlier access
YouTube.
To Try It Again.
YouTube.com/Linux Gamecast. Just go to the Try It Again section.
Honestly, take the money you would have spent on this game, spend it on us. It's a better return.
Let's say you're not one of our Patreon backers and you've actually played the first two games all the way through and you did everything. You just want to see how it ends.
Come on, Summer.
But it doesn't end here.
Summer.
So if you... if you're one of those people...
You know what? It does end here. Up next, hate mail section. We have some lovely fan mail from you guys that we're going to read and make fun of. It's good stuff.
And girls.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, it's the hate mail. If you don't know how to get in touch with us...
Fuck, I thought you were going to say emphysema mail, but go on.
Yeah. Well...
It can be two things.
Maybe.
Column A, column
but yeah,
A.
If you don't know how to get in touch with us at this point, what the hell are you doing with your life? It's linuxgamecast.com, contact button, it's easy enough, fill out the form. There's not much to it. So this week, we've actually had some racist people saying things.
Yeah, this is from Andre, and he's saying, I just want to say hello to the racist tree of you. I found out about your podcast over a year ago, and I've been following it on YouTube and on and off ever since. Your podcast is one of those things that help alleviate the train wreck that is my Monday. Unfortunately, due to my work and gaming preference situation, I don't currently use Linux and have not been using it for some time. Though day by day, I'm getting closer to switching back, and I use your podcast for almost all my Linux gaming news and updates. So thanks for the content. Also, to the guy suggesting splitting the podcast, just use the seek bar, man. That's why it's there. Well, you know, Andre, thanks for being a fan. Here's the thing about ditching Windows, though. I understand if you have to do it for your work purposes, but if you have a work computer, you can just leave it on there and leave the rest of your computers untainted by that garbage. But the best way to get rid of your Windows is just to cold turkey that fucker. Drop it. Don't look back.
Yeah.
Hey, man. Jordan speaks from experience. The first time I met Jordan, he was a filthy, doobying heathen.
Yep.
I mean, he told me, he was like, hey, man, I'm a gamer, man. I'm like, well, we're going to change that, aren't we?
That was the thing that switched over was there was enough games on Linux at the time to keep me busy, and I was using my Windows partition less and less, and I'm just like, whatever, I could use the extra hard drive space. Blew it away, and I noticed really no change in my life, so except I didn't have to deal with Windows, and that made it better.
Yeah, for me it was it was Fatan too. I know that's kind of posh to mention Fadentu on this show. Never mind again,
posh.
I do it, but
posh!
I like how people remember what the fuck a Fadentu is. They don't.
Posh!
It was a very successful distro. So successful, in fact,
that it died.
Fute had no way of supporting it, and it eventually died. So, yeah. But yeah, Fudentu for me was like, I don't need Windows anymore. It's like, and then Steam came out for Linux, and I don't need Windows anymore.
Absolutely, definitely. I mean, thanks for watching this nightmare fuel. I'm supporting it if you do or you don't. I mean, it's one, the biggest thing is, hey, you know, you can do our Amazon links and all that. We didn't care. Just tell somebody. I know, I think Mira's watching the show because Fox Dog. It's like, hey, check the show out and watch it. I mean, just watch it. That's what we care. Because we want to share the technology and what we know. Because I'm kind of getting to that point. I went cold turkey on Windows in 1995.
on your Deck Alpha workstation, yeah.
I still have a Deck Alpha that runs Windows NT, son. So fuck off. if you don't know.
It's just there to increase his power bill every month.
It's awesome. And I guarantee you, much like my Sun boxes, the thing probably still boots.
So speaking of Windows,
I can't wrap my head around when I'm finishing a damn sentence, Pedro. Really the only excuse anyone legitimately has, because we do hear this more often than not, and they're like, well, I got certain particular programs that only run under Windows. Like, you know, you can like spool up a VMware instance for free sauce, or you can do the, what is Oracle,
Zen, or he'll just use a Zen.
And do that for free. And they're like, oh, bots. Well, that particular game, I mean, not game, application required. Exactly. I mean, you got to do that. You got to make the choice, and you got to realize that some people will consider you an entitled person because you're like, oh, well, I don't want to pay $200 for a Windows license and do all that. And that's just kind of how things roll.
I just like my operating system to not phone home to Microsoft. But I use Fedora, so it doesn't.
I just like my operating system to let me do what I want whenever I want and not bug me whenever, oh, there's an update.
Well,
you should
speaking
reboot.
Of
no.
operating
yeah,
systems.
What I want is to go to the next hate mail. Yeah.
Yeah. So Ranos asks on the Steam Machine P video that Sandy recorded. he asks, can Windows be installed on the Steam machines overall? Why would you want to put Windows on Steam machines when all the hardware is like packed together and there's a mess of cables everywhere you look is beyond me. Unless, of course, you're talking about the OS, at which point I have to say that Alienware tried that. Why don't you ask them how successful?
Well, they got the Alienware Alpha and I think J-Man will agree with me. It's a bit dodgy how they present.
Just a bit.
Here's SteamOS and here's our Alienware Alpha, because here's the catch, Brad. If you're going to call something Steam Machine, the only saving grace out of this whole debacle of the Steam Machine launch was Valve's, and you can only call it a Steam Machine if it's running SteamOS. Period.
Yes.
End of fuck mothering story.
What one final point? In between the elemental plane of fire and water is the elemental plane of Steam, and they've actually bound a Steam elemental to the bootloader. The bootloader itself is unlocked, so you can go try and install your Windows on your Steam machine, but that fucker will attack you. That's
it
not
will.
Pretty.
I mean, P-Man, show him.
What?
And on that bombshell, let's cue the music. You can always find us around 9:30 Eastern Standard Moon Time. If you're wondering what that is, just type in into the Googs time, Athens, Georgia. It'll give you a bit of a hint. Take it. I'm at Vin Stone on the Twitter Nets, plus Vin Stone on the G Pluses. Write to me. I'll scream back in your direction.
I'm Jordan Svung. You can find me at The Burning Fool on Twitter, plus Jordan Svung on Google Plus. And if you write to me, I'll just cower in a corner because human contact scares me.
That literally came out of nowhere. I am Peter Mateusz. You can find me at Unaccounted4 on Twitter, or plus Peter Mateusz on Google Plus.
Just remember, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, at the end of the day, P-Man is incapable of doing the 10-finger death punch.
Seriously, posh? Posh!
Let me just give you the one
posh!
Finger.
Come on, okay. do it in stereo. Here, y'all. I'll help you out. Wait, hang on.
Pedro's mono only, stereo, unfortunately.
Because it's just the one finger.
I'll give you the... I'll give you, how about 1.5?
I'll give you the one finger salute. The finger's lower, much lower.
James Cameron.
Five dudes.